Priest of Huon, Freya, and Camille. Three crack Australian yachts that wrote an epic chapter in the sporting history of their country. The year 1965, off the southern coast of England. For the first time, a challenge from down under for the famed Admiral's Cup trophy. The acknowledged world championship for ocean racing yachts and the men who sail them. Let's have a try for the Admiral's Cup. A chance remark in a yacht club that captured the imagination of yachtsmen throughout Australia. Sportsman industrialist Sir James Kirby headed a four-man committee formed by the Cruising Yacht Club of Australia to organise the challenge. And Mr. Ron Irish, chairman of Rothmans, put the full weight of his company behind the team as official sponsor. A saga had begun. From the outset, Australia's Caprice of Huon staggered the yachting world by winning three of the four events in the series. Teammates, Freya and Camille, performed well to add valuable points. And, until the end of the lightest fastnet race on record, there was every chance of Australia winning the cup. But this was not to be. The cup remained with the title holders, Britain. Critics acclaimed the Australian effort. But as owner skipper of Caprice, Gordon Ingott remarked,
"The second place was just not good enough."
That was 1965. Australian yachtsmen challenged again for the 1967 team, and two new champions emerged from the elimination trials. Bob Crichton Brown's powerful 46-foot sloop, Belandra. She's the largest of the three Australian contenders and a goer in all conditions. Ted Kaufman's unconventional Mercedes 3. Conceived from Kaufman's own design theories, the dumpy, short-ended 40-foot sloop has never been unplaced in ocean racing. Mercedes 3 left for England the star of the team. And again, number 13, Caprice of Huon wins selection. Considered old even for the 1965 challenge, Caprice has been extensively refitted for this new challenge. Hard-driving Gordon Reynolds will be in charge. The elimination trials, the team training, and the final preparation of the three yachts for shipment on board the Williamson freighter Tisler had all gone according to plan. When the Arab-Israeli war closed the Suez Canal, with Tisler already at sea, it seemed impossible that the yachts could arrive in England in time. Tisler was rerouted to Cape Town, where the Union Castle liner Southampton Castle stood by to load the yachts for a fast trip to England. Mercedes owner Ted Kaufman flew to Cape Town to supervise the transshipment. And although valuable days had been lost, it did appear that the yachts would now arrive in time. But even as crew members left Sydney's Kingsford Smith Airport by Qantas V-Jet for London, there was still some anxiety as to whether the yachts would be in England when they arrived. At London Airport, the travel-weary crews receive a warm welcome and the news that their yachts will arrive in time. The Australian team soon had their first taste of English conditions and their first view of the team to defend the Cup for Britain. Norima 5, Prospect of Whitby, and Firebrand. Mercedes, in her first sail, shows great form that marks her as a potential winner, in spite of the incredible tide conditions of the Solent waters. Cowes Week, with all the colour and excitement which, for more than a century, has drawn boat lovers from all points of the globe. Some just to relax. Others for the more serious task of getting their yachts first across the line. With only days to go before the first Admiral's Cup event, final adjustments are carried out. Meticulous attention is given to the smallest detail. First race of the four-race series is the 225-mile channel race which carries double points for Admiral's Cup contestants. A record number of 26 yachts representing nine nations has entered this year's series. Caprice won this event in 1965, when conditions for the start off the Royal Albert Dock Club at Southsea were almost identical. Philandra makes a good start as the fleet of over 100 heads for the first mark. Caprice sets the pace and is the first to set a spinnaker. The rest of the fleet soon follows suit. Mercedes, reveling in her first taste of English Channel conditions. After the start at Southsea, the yachts round the Royal Sovereign light vessel in the Channel, south to Le Havre on the French coast, back round Horse Sand Fort, and then to the finish at Southsea. The yachts finished in the early hours of Sunday morning with a great result for Australia. Mercedes third, Philandra fourth, and Caprice seventh, putting the team 26 points ahead of Britain. Excitement runs high for the second race with the arrival of the Royal Yacht Britannia with members of the royal family aboard. England's top defender, Norima Five, poses a major threat to Australia's chances of taking the series. The Britannia Cup, first of the two 30-mile races around the buoys within the Solent, the area of protected water between the Isle of Wight and the English coast. A steady 12-knot breeze for the start. Caprice is badly balked on the line, and two similar incidents force her from 4th to 74th place before the first mark. Norima is sailing beautifully. Philandra tacks just ahead of Oryx of France to join the leaders in the beat to the windward mark. Just the stern of the French schooner, Penduic Free. By the first mark, the wind has dropped to almost a drifter. Caprice has made up valuable time and is again in the running, having passed 50 yachts on the last leg. Norima, in these light airs, gets good value from her lightweight spinnaker. At the Bramble Buoy, Philandra rounds and squares away for the next mark. Just astern, Oryx of France. Caprice has really made up ground, dropping boat after boat astern with a magnificent display of power sailing. Around the mark, Mercedes shies her spinnaker, climbing to windward to blanket Prospect of Whitby. The 50-foot French schooner, Penduic Free, carrying every inch of sail. She rounds Saltmead Buoy, hoists her spinnaker, and takes off. Firebrand has established herself with the leading boats, a distinct threat to Australia's point score. She is to prove Britain's most successful boat of the series. Of the Division 1 boats, leading Division 2, Australia's flyer, Mercedes 3. On the leg to the last mark, Philandra, Mercedes and Caprice are in close company. Baron de Rothschild's giant Gitana, not an Admiral's Cup contender, leads to the mark. But watch Penduic round inside Gitana and claw her way up to windward and ahead. Caprice drops her spinnaker right at the mark, just astern of Firebrand, for the work to the finish line. At the finish, Penduic leads Gitana across. America's top performer, Rabbit 2, Britain's Firebrand and Mercedes cross the line only seconds separating them. Rabbit later withdrew, and it's Mercedes first, Caprice Hawk and Valandra Max. Australia now leads Britain by 27 points with two races to go. 2 days later, the Solent again for the New York Yacht Club Challenge Cup, 30 miles around the corner. The breeze is light and fluky for the start, but the weather forecast is for strong, blustery conditions later in the day. After the first mark, it's a spinnaker run in a westerly breeze. Hard astern of her teammate Valandra, Caprice begins to feel the freshening of a breeze which will build dramatically throughout the race. An indication of things to come. In real schooner weather, Ken Hewitt makes the most of the fresh going. America's Figaro, re-rigged from Yule to Cutter just before this series, is showing great form on her improved handicap. It's the weather the Australians like, with a promise of harder winds on the way. America's Rabbit joins Britain's Naluna around the mark. It's piping in now at around 25 knots. Although many lose complete control of their sails in the fresh conditions, the Australian crews handle theirs with apparent ease. The forward hands discover they're not just there for the ride. Rounds the last mark hard to windward in gusts of over 30 knots. Keeps hard in, Genoa driving, Caprice gets her lead gunwale under and romps for the finish line. Designed for these conditions, Valandra drives for home. Figaro crosses the line, and Bloodhound, skippered by the Duke of Edinburgh, has her best result of Tower's week. Francis Oryx and Valandra duel right to the line. Ken Buick fails to cope with the conditions and had her worst result so far. Caprice, coming home well, ties it up for Australia. And it's third, fourth, and fifth placing for the team. As the English boats finish, Ireland's Moonduster, number 411, puts Naluma about on the line, allowing America's Rabbit to slip through. costing the Lima valuable points. Australia's lead widens again. With Australia leading by 44 points and only one race to go, Britain pulls out all stops. Her three yachts are slipped, and all competing boats are given a thorough workover in preparation for the grueling 600-mile fastnet race. The fastnet race is worth triple points, and Australia's navigators, Bill Fesk, Caprice, Stan Darling, Philandra, and Dick Hammond, Mercedes, are taking no chances on tactical errors. Britain could retain the cup. The start. In conditions that belie Fastnet's blustery reputation, it was light, fickle winds like this that destroyed Australia's chances in 1965, suiting the British team with its local knowledge of tide and course. Division 2 boats drift across the line. And there's a recall at the start. Mercedes, well inshore, dodges the incoming tide with barely sufficient breeze to fill her sails. By now, Division 2 boats have drifted up with Division 1. Further inshore, Caprice is right out of wind. Division 3 starts in a bunch at the windward end of the line. Someone must have forgotten to tell the bargeman this was race day. Over 150 yachts are on the way to the Fastnet Rock, and amongst them the 26 Admiral's Cup competitors. It's an ideal day for the spectators, even if it is a bit crowded for the yachtsmen. The breeze begins to pick up as Penn Duett tacks for the open sea. Within a moment, the whole fleet has caught the new breeze. Mercedes' crew trims her sails. Caprice hardens sheets. Philandra tacks out through the sails. In the freshening breeze, Narima leads Firebrand and Prospect of Whitby out to sea. The British boats were built for these waters and conditions. This could be their race. America's Figaro passed the needle. Philandra, sixth boat to reach the open sea and sailing well up to handicap. America's Rabbit 2 is a brilliant ocean racer. She's designed and skippered by Dick Carter, who won the last Fastnet race. From Cowes, yachts pass around the south of England to the Fastnet Rock off the southern coast of Ireland, back around Bishop's Rock to finish off the breakwater at Plymouth 600 miles later. The first view of grim Fastnet Rock between rain squalls. Philandra has made excellent time and moves up to fifth position of the Admiral's Cup yachts. The breeze is light, but the overnight swell is still turbulent as she rounds the rock. Once around, the breeze strengthens again for the work home. Astern, an English yacht is sighted, still reaching for Fastnet. The race is really on. And not far behind, Caprice.
We're in total, right? But you've got to take risks in a deal like this. We had things perfectly under control. We knew we were close. And we dashed the ground very nicely, and our maneuver came off very nicely.
46 minutes astern of Caprice, Mercedes 3.
As we approached the rock, we had a good following breeze with a shy spinnaker, and we were traveling at about 6 or 7 knots. Gordon Dunn, who had done most of the cooking, alighted on deck with a smile on his face for the first time. And at this stage, we were very happy with our position, and we felt that if we could sail as well as we had been up to date, that we had a fairly good chance of taking home the Admiral's Cup.
Bonanza is setting a cracking pace in Division 1. 24 hours ago, it was a different story.
And after 3 hours, cutting up the oars and part of the Dutch furniture, we were able to draw the steering gear up in such a fashion that it gave no further problem.
Germany's Rubin heads for the finish. A good result by Oryx could lift France well up on the point score. But reveling in these conditions, Malandra is giving nothing away. America's Thunderbird, a fiberglass yacht of the Cal 40 class. A record holder in America, he fails to match the pace set by the Australian. To finish, he could do well on handicap. Not far behind, Ruby. A beam of Ruby, the Italian yacht Leventardi, and Eric.
Was going like a rocket. We had ample breeze to keep us going along. We had our reaching gear up, and we were knocking off our maximum hull speed all the time.
With 4 days behind her and just 1 hour to the finish, Balandra creaming along. Her beautifully cut sails drawing perfectly. Thunderbird sets an unusual full-cut reaching Genoa, ideal for these conditions, tapping on every ounce of pace in a last determined effort. But for Balandra, the race is almost over. Spinnaker set, she runs for Plymouth Hoe and the finishing line, completing a magnificent performance. But not yet out of the running, Narima is fighting every inch of the way. Britain has not lost the cup yet. Firebrand, racing under Shai Spinnaker, is grimly determined to gain every point. America's Thunderbird has sailed well, but is out of handicap calculation. Then, dramatically, in a lightning breeze, Mercedes sails in, out of the blue, for a spectacular finish. Just astern of Mercedes, Caprice of Huon heads for the line. Australia looks assured of three good handicap places. The Admiral's Cup is almost in the bag. Mercedes circles the finishing line, waiting to cheer teammate Caprice, who crosses the line only 20 minutes later. In ocean racing, there can be no final result until the last boat finishes, and Firebrand has no intention of letting up. But for Caprice and Australia, the race and the series are over. The Australians are happy, and so they should be. Results are finally confirmed. Australia first by a record margin of over 100 points.
We haven't really finished yet, because the most important thing is the Admiral's Cup by Lord Slighton Yard and the rest of the crew.
And the Admiral's Cup makes its longest journey. From the historic Royal Ocean Racing Club in London to a young club at Rochetters Bay, Sydney, the Cruising Yacht Club of Australia. Congratulations, Caprice of Huon, Ballandra, and Mercedes Three. 1967 will long be remembered as the year you brought back the Admiral's Cup. ¶¶